Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jason Vitello. I'm the president of the Colorado Public Health Association and the behavioral health coordinator for Denver Public Health. And I'll be presenting today on public health for public safety. You'll get a chance to meet my friends and colleagues here in a bit, but what I'm gonna do to set it off is provide an introduction and the background and the context for this initiative. So in light of the high profile events of last year related to police violence and the subsequent nationwide response, the protests and the demand for reform, conversations have elevated related to police defunding and resource reallocation. And it's within this context that we find ourselves where, you know, we have seen traditionally cops, courts, and cages, or the criminal legal system, as a primary response in addressing what we believe and perceive to be public health problems, right? So problems related to homelessness, substance use and addiction, victimization, mental health problems, and poverty. We believe that a shift in focus should move to public health. And that's what this initiative is about. Next slide, please. It's our hope that you come away today with a better understanding of the potential public health role within you know, this initiative and what a public health approach to public safety might entail, especially within the context of the historically underserved, right? Those disproportionately impacted by violence, victimization, and incarceration, namely people of color and men and young adults. So a bit of background. In 2015, I began to collaborate with the Colorado Criminal Justice Reform Coalition. Many of you are familiar with the CCJRC in their efforts to better understand the needs and the experiences of crime survivors. And a significant milestone of this crime survivor movement was the publication of the Victims Speak Report. This was an independent survey of about 500 individuals from the Denver metro area, all of whom self-reported being a victim of at least one crime in the last 10 years. People of color were intentionally oversampled to gain explicit knowledge into their experiences of victimization. And the key findings of this report included the following. Communities of color are disproportionately impacted by violent crime. A third of victims do not report the crime to law enforcement. Victimization, especially repeat victimization, can lead to significant trauma, but few receive their services or treatment they need to heal and recover, right? So within the criminal legal system, we have this false belief that one is either a victim or a perpetrator, which ignores the fact that the vast majority of violent offenders were victims of violence and trauma themselves long before they ever harmed anyone else, right? So measures should be taken to prevent violence from occurring to begin with and disrupting that cycle. Also, across all racial demographics, crime survivors believe that the criminal legal system treats people of color differently, whether they are the accused or are the victim of a crime. And finally, by a wide margin, crime survivors across all demographics, political, racial, cultural, believe that prevention, education, treatment, and rehabilitation improve public safety more than incarceration. So the crime survivors movement would campaign for what has since become the Community Crime Victim Services Program. Myself and several others testified in favor of House Bill 1409, which would go on to reallocate about $850,000 a year out of the Department of Corrections and base it in the Office of Violence Prevention at the State Public Health Department. So public health for Public Safety, a community movement to engage in hate crime survivors, is an intervention funded by the Latino Coalition's Community Crime Victim Services Grant, which upholds that public safety should not just be a matter of law enforcement and criminal justice, but of public health. A mission of public health is to keep society healthy by informing practice and facilitating access to effective care for all people. And it's also our role to keep society safe by preventing the spread of disease through research, education, systems coordination, and community engagement. And we believe this holds true for the communicable disease of violence, right? From the symptoms in our most impacted communities to the systemic causal factors. Next slide, please. One more. And I think it is probably helpful for folks to have a sense of public health and what we mean when we say public health. A good anecdote I like to use, or analogy rather, is, you know, the medical model, for instance, right? So say you have a village and there's 100 people that live in the village and they drink from a well and 99 of them get sick, right? So the medical approach is everyone lines up and we hand out medication to everyone who got sick from that well. Whereas the public health approach is, let's take a look at that well and what's going on there that caused the sickness to begin with. So public health is defined as the art and science of preventing disease, prolonging life, and promoting health through the organized efforts of society. And there's two parts of this definition that I'd like to attend to. First, health. Health is defined as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. And that's according to the World Health Organization. And then organized efforts of society. Within public health, we understand that health is determined by far more than one's access to healthcare or what happens inside the brick and mortar walls of a hospital, right? Health starts in our homes, our schools, our workplaces, our neighborhoods, and our communities. So that means it's not just healthcare systems or local public health departments that contribute to the health of individuals and societies. So we seek input from and assistance in the coordination of cross-sector partners from health, from education, from social services, the criminal legal system, policy, and the private sector. So public health draws on knowledge from a broad range of disciplines, including medicine, epidemiology, sociology, psychology, criminology, education, and economics, and that's best practice, community members themselves, individuals who come from sectors that are most impacted. Next slide, please. So the public health approach is a four-step process that is rooted in the scientific method. It can be applied to violence, as well as other health problems that affect entire populations. We begin by defining the problem, identifying risk and protective factors. We develop and test prevention strategies and assure widespread adoption of effective injury prevention principles and strategies. Right? This includes not just helping to promote best or better practices, but policy reform. And we believe that science and justice should drive policy and not the fear-mongering of power-hungry politicians, for instance. These strategies should be utilized in all efforts to cease the spread of the communicable disease of violence from the structural root causes to its symptoms within our communities. And toward this end, Denver Public Health has recruited a diverse team of individuals from these communities to engage in a process of community-based participatory research. And these individuals, dynamic individuals and friends of mine, all have lived experience and powerful stories related to violence, victimization, and healing. The Public Health for Public Safety leadership team has committed itself to the goal of preventing violence and victimization and to the promotion of trauma-informed, culturally responsive interventions systemic transformations, and individual and community healing. Unfortunately, the fashionable term community engagement is thrown around pretty cheaply in this work, very oftentimes being nothing more than lip service when outcomes and strategies are prescriptive. But we really just strive to maintain adherence to authentic community engagement where the team members have the voice and the power to determine the course of this work. And with that, I'm going to pass it on to my colleague, Aaron, who will describe the community-based participatory research in a little more detail, and then you will hear from some of the rest of our team. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Aaron Harris. I am the evaluator for our behavioral health team at Denver Public Health, and have been kind of the support for the leadership team and guiding them through this process. So I'm just gonna go over quickly the methodology of how we went about doing our survey to collect the information for the Public Health for Public Safety report. So we began, after we hired our leadership team, to begin our process, we reviewed both the victim speak report by the Colorado Criminal Justice Reform Coalition and a report titled Crime Survivors Speak by the Alliance for Safety and Justice out of California. And then following reviewing two of those reports, we brainstormed answers to questions about what surprised you when you read those reports, what was concerning to you, what do you want to know more about, and what was encouraging to you. Then with the leadership team, went through a kind of a brainstorm session where we categorized and prioritized those ideas into larger themes. And then we used dot voting to prioritize the themes that the leadership team really wanted to focus on for the remainder of the research process. We then went through a process to determine what we wanted to learn from about each of those theme areas, who we wanted to learn that information from, and how we wanted to learn that information. And it was determined that a survey was the best first step to understand this information, followed by focus groups that we are currently finishing up and will be excited to hopefully share those results within the year, next few months with everyone from the focus groups. And it was determined that a survey would be the best way to understand at a high level what motivates individuals to report or not report a crime that they have experienced, the experiences of those that have reported crimes, the experiences of those that have interacted with the criminal legal system, and community perception of law enforcement. So the survey was distributed over 12 weeks from November 24th, 2019 to February 14th, 2020. Right before everything shut down and changed. And they distributed the survey through social media, email, their networks, through text message, flyers that had a QR code, organized in-person events, which is really where we got the best response rate from, was those organized existing in-person group events. We had a total of 240 responses that were collected over those 12 weeks. And we recognize that this is a small sample size, so these results might not be generalizable to the larger population of crime survivors. We then did data analysis primarily with Qualtrics and Excel, and qualitative analysis was completed of our open-ended responses to do thematic coding with three members of the leadership team and myself and my colleague Janet. Additionally, we also collected stories from the leadership team that are included in our report on this to share their experiences. And to give you an idea of who we surveyed, looking at race and ethnicity, predominantly those we surveyed were individuals of color, being Black and Hispanic Latinx, and then 23% were white non-Hispanic. With looking at the age groups of our respondents, we had pretty even distribution with the exception of those 66 years and over, meaning we had pretty good representation from all different age groups, making it a pretty representative sample. And then we also asked people what their highest level of education was. However, we didn't use this in our analysis because we were going to use it as a proxy indicator for income. But as one of our leadership team members pointed out, you can be very well educated and still be poor. So we chose not to use this in our analysis. But I wanted to give you an idea of what the education level of those that we surveyed, predominantly high school GED and some college, followed by bachelor's degree, associate's degree, and master's degree. And now I will turn it over to Janet. Are you presenting this section?
Okay. Yeah.
And Janet.
Hi, everyone. My name is Janet Alvarado. I'm the staff assistant at Denver Public Health. And next slide. Okay, so one of our key findings was that 8 out of 10 individuals reported being a victim of a crime in their lifetime, with people of color being most likely to have experienced the crimes. And then our second key finding was that individuals from ages 26 to 35 and people of color reported that they are the highest rates of repeat victimization. Our key finding number 3 was that men and people of color disproportionately experience both violent and nonviolent crimes. And I'll hand it over to Toya.
Yep. Hi, everybody. Thank you, Janet. So I am going to talk a little bit about inequities in the criminal justice system. And we're just going to go over some of the key findings that we found here. Obviously, this is a big, deep rabbit hole full of different ways that you can look at all the inequities and everything that's going on. But we were able to pull some just underlining key findings, and then we can have some discussion about that. Please feel free to interact with us and drop things in the chat. We are here. The leadership team is here and different people are here just to have these types of conversations. Let's go to the next slide. Thank you, Erin. So one of our first key finding is that 1 out of 4 respondents didn't receive any services for the crimes they experienced and reported to law enforcement. And this is a huge key finding because we found that the ones that did receive services said that they were able to better overcome and deal with and cope with the situation that was at hand at that time. So if we have 1 out of 4 not receiving any services at all, then, you know, there's a big gap there. Because as you can see, we have all these different services and you can see the percentages of what people were able to take advantage of. But 23 said that they had no services offered. So the question is, why isn't there something happening within our system where everybody, no matter what's happening, is offered some sort of services or even follow up to see if they were able to take advantage of those services, as you can imagine. So it's very important that people at least get some sort of interaction with service providers due to their interaction or whatnot with law enforcement and the criminal legal system. Next slide. Our next key finding is that 80% of respondents were not aware that you do not have to report a crime to law enforcement in order to receive services.
Isn't this something that everybody should know type of thing? Shouldn't you just know that you don't have to report a crime or in order to receive services? But the reality is that 80% of people, they just don't know that. And I'll be honest, I didn't know that. I thought for sure I had to be somewhat in the system in order to receive professional services. So one of the big underlining concepts that kept popping up was this quote right here below. And the quote is, "I was simply re-victimized and minimized by insensitive law enforcement officers. The victim advocates show greater understanding and assisted me through the process." So that was from a Black female, 55 to 65 years of age.
Key findings 3 and 4. 3 is that being a victim of a crime is significantly associated with having committed an act of violence. 9 out of 10 victims also committed an act of violence. And then 4 is that repeat victimization is significantly associated with having committed an act of violence. You know, so I think that we all know this, and sometimes we forget that we're living in a society where everything kind of overlaps with each other, which is what this graphic is over here to the right of your screen. So you have victim, offender, community, and that little happy face in the middle where everything is just kind of overlapping in some way, shape, or form. So it's really hard to really separate out people's experiences and just say, I'm just a victim, I'm just an offender, I'm just a community member, when we all have to interact and live together and find solutions as a community for whatever's happening and support people through whatever they're going through. Next slide. Key findings 5 and 6. 5 is that people of color and men are more likely to have reported interacting with the criminal legal system. That should not be a surprise to anybody. And 6 is that 6 out of 10 that had interacted with the criminal legal system criminal legal system did not receive the services that they needed, such as mental health services and legal services. So that just kind of loops us all the way back to what one of our first key findings was. And this is just some statistics to support that. Go ahead. So our next session is going to be reporting of crimes. And I'm not quite sure whose section this is. I'm going to hand it over to...
That's me. Thank you, Victoria.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Troy Grimes. I'm part of the leadership team. Community member. I'm kind of that circle in the middle of the diagram that Latoya shared. I'm an offender, I'm a survivor, and I'm a community member. So just want to share with you all some of the feedback and the findings that we got from the survey in regards to the reporting of crimes. Next slide, please. So there's 2 key findings here. First one, slightly more than half of the respondents had reported reported the crimes that they experienced. And also the top reasons for reporting were concern for safety, feeling like they had no choice, to recover property, and wanting justice. So in terms of where we were on the national meter, we're right about the same at 56%. The national rate of reporting crimes is 54. Next. Key finding number 3 was in regards to experiences reporting crimes were mixed. For those that had a bad experience, it was mostly due to lack of follow through by law enforcement and being treated like a criminal when they were actually the victim, which Latoya spoke a little bit on. And this led to many saying that they might or would not report a crime again in the future, which is obviously very concerning, because if you've been victimized or criminalized and because of that experience, you feel like you would not report again, then we can all imagine all of the dangers, trauma, et cetera, that could accompany that. There's a quote here from one of the persons, female, 26 to 35 years old, Hispanic, Latinx. And she reported, "It's discouraging when you report a crime, but there is no follow-up or the assailant isn't held accountable." Next screen. Key finding number 4 and 5, those 16 to 25 years were the least likely to have reported the crimes they experienced. That's concerning to me, because as we know, there's quite a bit of crime being inflicted upon our communities, both on and involving our young people, 16 to 25 years. And then also men and people of color were less likely to report these crimes that they had experienced. I think in addition to good and bad experiences, you know, again, many of the respondents alluded to experiences of reporting crime that they experienced as being very emotional. You know, with it being a high emotional type of experience for our young folks, I think that we have to look at how we can do better about making it more comfortable for them to report these crimes and to reach out for the services that they may need during these times. Move forward, please. Key findings number six, top reasons given for not responding to a crime were lack of confidence in the legal system, mentality that it could be handled on their own, and a lack of clarity, uncertainty, and understanding. About half of survey respondents that had reported crimes in the past said that they may or may not report crimes again following their previous experiences. So again, this really looks to seem to be a problem if indeed we know that our youth are not reporting, and we know that people in general are not reporting because there is a lack of confidence in the legal system, and also because there's a lack of understanding. And so I know that Latoya spoke about, you know, not even knowing what resources are available to us and how we can access those and what are the qualifications in order for us to be to access those. So we have to do a better job. When I say we, I mean those that have the resources, those that are part of the legal system and the community. We all should be acting as one to make sure that we're providing an experience when crimes are inflicted that actually helps to minimize the trauma and strengthen the community rather than weaken it through a bad experience. Continue. Experiences such as the one described by a female young adult may be large cause of underreporting, our respondents being uncertain if they would report again in the future. So again, here's a quote of one of the respondents. Reporting was almost worse than being raped. There was alcohol involved and I was underage, so the police officers treated me like I was the criminal. They also treated me like being raped was my fault. This led me to being extremely shameful of what had happened to me. All of this is the reason I didn't report the second time. I'm a father of eight, and so testimonials such as this really, really touch inside of me. So, and really make me understand that, again, we need to do better. We need to do better. Move forward. Those 16 to 25 years were less likely to report, with 30% not reporting the crimes experienced, the highest number of non-reporting among all of the age groups. And this is similar to 2015 contacts between police and public survey also found that those 16 and 17 were least likely to report. So this is nothing new. It's nothing that powers that be don't know. And this is something that really needs to be addressed. Can we move forward, please? So we asked some questions as to why, and I've already shared some of those testimonials as to why. The most mentioned reasons was a lack of confidence in the legal system. Again, another testimonial to that fact is the cops never listened to the small brown girl. Any cop or reporting services never care for minorities. This was a feeling by one of the persons, American Indian, Alaskan Native, 16 to 25 years old. Moving forward. So we're gonna move on and talk about perceptions of law enforcement, which I think is a great segue, because we know from the previous section, the section I just reported, that especially our youth, 16 to 25, they seem to be speaking out their perception of law enforcement very loud and clear by their lack of reporting crimes and the reasons why not. So I'll pass this along to my colleague, Brother Ray. It's on you.
Yeah, my name is, let me put my camera on. There you go. My name is Ray. You know, I'm a former victim and perpetrator of violence in the community, but, you know, I have, you know, changed my ways and started with the community leadership team to help and make a positive difference in the community, especially with young people. I'm also a vice president of UCAM Metro Denver. And, you know, I live in a community that's still going through a lot of crime and violence and trauma. So, you know, this is part of my, I guess, retribution to society and making sure that my kids grow up in a safer environment than I did. So really, this section is just discussing how law enforcement is perceived, you know, by people of color and youth, as well as you know, how it continues to you know, continues on through generations of how the how people see law enforcement and authority figures in general. So you can go to the next slide, please. So the key findings, number one and number two, is 4 out of 10 respondents reporting have a negative perception of law enforcement. And, you know, this is almost double among people of color. And I'm sure you guys, anybody out there who has children or who is a person of color knows, you know, how it is to be profiled and how they feel when, you know, you see those flashing lights behind you, even if it's for something simple. So that's part of the reason for a lot of this, you know, negative reporting. And key finding number two is individuals aged 16 to 25 years were the most likely among all age groups to report a negative perception in crime. And again, it just goes back to, you know, sometimes cultural or, you know, community norms of how people perceive law enforcement and how you interact with the police officers when you are stopped for certain reasons. Next slide, please. Oh, wait, actually, I'm sorry, go back. Sorry, there is a quote here. I felt that justice is only given to those who seek, to those who seek it out for themselves. And that was a Latinx male, 36 to 45 years of age. And you go ahead and go to the next one now, sorry. 40% of the general public have a negative or extremely negative perception of law enforcement in their communities. And, you know, again, I'm sure, you know, everybody who's participating has been watching the news and see that there needs to be a lot of changes in the way law enforcement interacts with the public, and especially people of color and younger people. I think that's one of the biggest issues that we see, is that we need to get some more training for police officers and mental health and how to address, you know, communities that are, you know, that are afflicted with violence and trauma. And you go ahead and go to the next slide, please. Although 8 out of 10 people of color have an extremely negative perception of law enforcement, 65% of all the positive perceptions of law enforcement were from people of color. So, you know, even though there is a lot of negativity, there still are some positive, you know, positive interactions that people need to be aware of, that there are some, you know, there are good police officers out there to help the community, but there's a lot still that needs to be worked on. And I'm sorry, I was just looking at the pictures that everybody that we chose to put in here. There's a lot of people yelling with their arms crossed, so I like this one in particular. That's a good one. Looks like somebody's about to get spanked. So you can go ahead and go to the next slide, please. Young adults aged 16 to 25 reported that the most negative perception and interactions with law enforcement of all age groups who were asked. And, you know, me personally, when I was that age, I had a negative perception of law enforcement and authority in general. So I'm sure that comes to no surprise to anybody who has teenagers. And, you know, a lot of that, again, has to go with, I guess, cultural norms and the way that they're brought up in the home, how law enforcement is viewed in the home as well. And, you know, I think that this is one of the biggest issues that we also have to, you know, address when it comes to law enforcement, is teaching our children how to interact safely and properly with people, you know, with people in positions of authority, and how to also, you know, exercise your rights as well, you know, not letting either party overstep their bounds as far as, you know, interactions with the law. And you can go ahead and go to the next one. And the next steps and recommendations, I believe, is Latoya. Is that right?
Yeah, unless Henry's able to hop on. Henry, are you able to hop on and take care of this section?
Can you see me?
Yeah.
Hey. All right. Well, I'm here. Yes, ma'am.
Over to Henry.
Thanks, Ray. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Henry Price. I'm also a member of this team, as well as currently the civic engagement organizer for Colorado Criminal Justice Reform Coalition. This section that we're going to go over right now, close to the end, is next steps and recommendations. We've broken this down into three subsets, three categories, and we're going to briefly go over those. It should be real quick, something you guys probably already familiar with, but just wanted to jog your memory on some things. Next slide, please, Aaron. So the organization I currently work for, Colorado Criminal Justice Reform Coalition, as most of you guys know, is in the criminal justice policy space. We do a lot of criminal justice reform work. And as policymakers, one of the things that we saw with the crime victim, the victim speak report, the California report, as well as the Oregon initiative, is that there's a marginalized voice and a forgotten voice, often forgotten voice in community, that does not get elevated to the point to where their rights or their concerns are met. So this initiative, and even the CCVS initiative, Community Crime Victim Services initiative, was kind of born out of that concern. How do we elevate the voices of those who don't have anyone who traditionally supports them? Most of you folks here are practitioners or in the space or professionals, and are aware that, you know, even with the statutes of 1993, which are almost 30 years old now, the traditional voice have been, you know, middle-aged white women who went to the Capitol, who had the politic and power or the lobbying power to get in the face of folks and make these laws, which in some ways adversely affected, you know, communities of color and particularly minorities that are in this space. So what we think, based on the data that we found, would be influential in making this more inclusive is if we elevated those voices. And a couple of the ways that we thought as policymakers was trying to get increased funding. Again, that's born with some of the initiatives that's going on now. And there are a lot of good, you know, partners within this space in the state and in the immediate Denver metro area who work well with this. CICASA and you know, the Colorado Springs area and those folks who are working well with, you know, trying to make sure that those voices that are normally left out are elevated. We want to make sure that funding is in the community for culturally relevant and gender relevant services for victims to broaden accessibility. That may be more modalities of healing. It may be other services that are traditionally non-traditional, so to speak. We want to make sure that we create policy requiring ongoing comprehensive cultural and diversity inclusive training. DEI is the big topic right now. Everyone knows what that is and is on everyone's plate, but it also means how do you interact with the community? The community that, you know, we have our law enforcement and mental health professionals walking into is very diverse. And not everyone, as we've witnessed over the last couple of years, nationally known Elijah McClain, that no one knows how to de-escalate well. and it hasn't been done well. And so some of those trainings, some of that information, some of that inclusiveness that we want to see in community and we want our voice to be elevated in, you know, should be considered, you know, as policymakers in this space. We want to make counseling mandatory every 6 months, you know, for law enforcement. This space, as we all know, and I found out as Troy and as Ray said, I am in that cross-sectionality of offender and victim, you know, that kind of middle circle where, you know, there's a need to take care of yourself, take care of your mental health, take care of your mental wellness. You know, sometimes you just need a break, you know, from the trauma that you're trying to fix. And it's very necessary, I think, and we think that our law enforcement officers have access to that. And there may be some statutes or some regulations within internal policy that they can seek those things, but I think as policymakers, you know, we should make that mandatory. We should make that something that they seek out, not because they think that there's a need or they may have had an incident, but we want to make sure that the balance is there. We want to make sure that when you're out in the community and you're servicing kids, they're not being handcuffed and thrown on hot pavement, you know, in 95 degree weather for 2 hours for no reason. We want to make sure that there's, you know, no more chokeholds, no more ketamine issues, none of those things that, you know, normally as you're, you know, you're thinking consciously about humanity, those are some of the things that you probably wouldn't do if you were your best self. Next slide, please. I don't know if most of you all are service providers here, but as direct service providers, the hope is that you would help step into some of the spaces where we can help educate the public. I think I saw in the chat that there was a comment that a lot of crime victims don't report. And that's true. Excuse me. That's true. So what and how can we make non-reporting a non-factor? How can we make sure that, you know, you're not mandated to work exclusively and extensively and thoroughly with law enforcement to the completion of your case in order for you to receive services from the Victims Advocacy Fund? We got to do better. That's what we feel. We got to do better for folks who experience trauma in our community, because if you don't, you know, feel like there's a win for you, and some of us who come from very crime-ridden communities. I'm originally from St. Louis, raised in, you know, and Ray and Troy in the far north or northeast. How do we make sure that, you know, our communities, when we don't feel like we're safe on the streets to report certain crimes and to continue through law enforcement practices, that we're still able to receive the services? Our families are still able to receive the services. Service providers also, we want you to be able to work with law enforcement to improve the reporting process. How do we make sure that that stays confidential? How do we make sure that people stay out of harm's way and not be used as pawns in the political game of community versus, you know, system? That's something that hopefully we can get away from. Also with the data collection and reporting by police departments to ensure that it's collected accurately. There's a need for the public now more so than ever to be informed. And in the past, prior to maybe 2000-ish, there wasn't, you know, so much readily available information to community via the internet. But times have changed. And even with the statutes in 93, times have changed. That's 30 years old. Their policy is 30 years old. We got to improve systems. We got to improve ways that people can have access. We got to improve ways that people can get to these, you know, these, I guess, authoritative systems, authoritative figures in community that have the oversight and the well-being of people to do their public service work. How do we make sure that the public is getting that data for what the law enforcement are getting, so that we know what's going on in our community, so that we're not caught by surprise, so that there isn't repeat victimization, so there isn't predatory behavior in community. All of these things play a part in the community being informed and aware and having information readily available at their fingertips. Next slide, please. Advocates, that includes everyone in the space. What are some of the community-based solutions that you all want to invest in, that you want to see, that you know work. As I mentioned earlier, and has been mentioned before during this presentation, there are a lot of folks here in this space and that are not in this space currently that, you know, are doing really good work. But some of that work is done in the shadows. You know, there are folks who really need the services and really need the access to services and really need to really have some help in community to feel connected. I'm old school, so this is kind of a bias that I have, but I come from a place to where I knew everybody, you know, within probably a 10-mile radius of where I lived, went to school with them, played with them, fought with them, you know, knew their parents knew me. You know, where now do you really go, you know, in community unless you live there for a while to know what resources are available? How do you know what mental health is available, stable, affordable housing? What assistance is available? Unless you're really trying to mine these, you know, information, you know, sites for yourself, usually those are held in community spaces, and we want to make sure that community has a voice and is uplifted in a way that makes it not only accessible to everyone, but, you know, palatable and understandable, digestible, so that folks can really get what they need. And if it's private, and if they want to stay, you know, outside of the norm or under the radar, then they have that option, but at least they know what's available to them. We want to, you know, investment in healing, restoration, systematic transformations. These are all things that go hand in hand. How do we be more culturally responsive? As we all know, our community is diverse. It's changing. There are more immigrants than Black and brown folks. There are more immigrants than what are traditional than Latinx or, you know, African-American members of community. And how do we get these folks who have never heard of trauma or who have never heard of therapy even to really translate that into their language to where the language of their heart is really met and they're is culturally competent? How do you tell someone from Eritrea, you know, about trauma, you know, and trauma and therapy when they're faced with things that are different than any of our life experiences could even imagine, you know? So I'm just putting it out there just so we can kind of think about, you know, the folks that aren't like us, the folks that don't look like us, that don't sound like us, that don't in our immediate circles. How do we make sure that they are represented in that space as well? And hopefully you all can be thought partners and thought provokers in that space to where we can, you know, further collaborate on these things and make sure that the voice of the victim that are in marginalized spaces are elevated. Next slide, please. What's next for us? CCVS, Community Crime Victim Services. Continue research, conduct virtual focus groups. We've been doing that for the past few months. And as some of you have asked in the chat, I'm not certain. I mean, Aaron can speak to that after I wrap up about what, or Jason, what that may look like going forward. How do we get those focus group information out? What are we doing with that? How are we making sure that those things are accessible to you all so that you can be more well-informed in your spaces of treatment and spaces to where you're directly servicing community? We're going to make sure that we document and report. We're going to make sure that we present new developments, and we're also going to make sure that we support the community in implementing changes that support victims. That's our call to this work. That's our charge, if you will. That's most of our passions. Either we've been on both sides or we've been, you know, affected, directly impacted by some type of criminality or victimization, family members, so on and so forth, the community that may have been a victim of crime. And so how do we make sure that we support those folks, make sure we support what the community does, and make sure that the community is well-rounded in the resources that they have? So that's my little piece here to ask of you guys, and really appreciate you all sitting in on this, and I'll turn it back over to Aaron.
Yes, so I think that's all we have. Just Q&A with our leadership team and us. I will add on to what Henry was talking about is our plan for focus groups is we're conducting our last one this evening at 6 o'clock tonight, and then we'll do one with the leadership team themselves And then we'll compile all of the transcripts and be going through and doing thematic coding of those. We'll write a short report that then we'll attach to our existing report to share out with everyone. Stop sharing. If anyone has questions, feel free to either put them in the chat or you can unmute yourself if you'd like.
There was one question earlier on that asked whether you all collected any data on types of crime, so like Victim Rights Act crime versus non-Victim Rights Act crimes.
Yeah, so we looked at violent versus non-violent crimes. I am looking for the table. Of where we define that. So we looked at things like violent versus nonviolent. So violent including like murder, rape, sexual assault, harassment, and then nonviolent was more kind of property theft, identity theft, and robbery, I believe. So whatever VOCA and kind of is the standard definition of violent versus nonviolent crimes is kind of what we asked about. Looks like there's one that says, and maybe Jason, you can answer this or the leadership team. In a perfect world, what would you want the Sunset Review to tell the world about CCVS as far as successes and how to take a page from your excellent work to replicate the program for communities around the country?
Thank you. That's an excellent question. I'd like to open it to the leadership team members as well. But for me, I think a really critical role of public health, and you know, I talked about some of the roles of public health earlier on, but for me, my favorite is public health at its best. We seek to change the givens, right? Some of y'all might remember that back in the day, you could smoke a cigarette on an airplane or you know, in a hospital. And now we're dealing with other givens, right? The fact that there's more mental health treatment housed in the criminal legal system than in the healthcare system, right? That's a given that we would like to change. And a big part of how we do that is through changing the narrative. And to do that, I think a pivotal role of public health is to serve as the amplifier, right? Community is the guitar and public health is the amplifier. And we aim to unmute and amplify the voices of the unheard to make sure that their stories are interwoven and heard within the dominant social and political discourse. Stories are powerful in that they can change the way we perceive our individual, but also our collective experiences. Stories can change minds, which in turn can change policy, which in turn can change the material conditions of real people. And to me, that's what I hope this work can accomplish, is change the narrative, you know? And a lot of you, I'm sure, also remember, you know, back in the 80s and even the 90s, turning on the TV every night and seeing Black and brown bodies hauled off and thrown into cages. And you know, the war on drugs. These were predators, these were dangerous people that needed to be put in chains and locked up. And then we had the opioid epidemic, right, of today. Before that, we had the heroin epidemic in the 90s. And the response, the societal response to that was far different. These are people that need help, they need treatment. So creating that compassionate response to you know, we are, our prison systems are full of, first of all, violent offenders who were victims and who were never treated for their own trauma or for their statuses as victims or survivors themselves. They've only been treated as part of their punishment. But beyond that, full of nonviolent offenders, drug offenders, people who need mental health treatment or substance use and addiction treatment. So anything that can happen to push us further in that direction. And there's a lot I feel going on in Colorado and Denver in particular, with the STAR program and you know, high profile discussions about police reform and what a community response could look like. So I feel like we're in a pivotal time in the history of our nation, but in a really, really important space here in Denver where some of the groundwork is laid for conversations to take place, conversations that weren't being had even a year ago. And the promise and possibility of real work being accomplished as a result. But I would love to hear from other members of the team what success looks like to you all.
I'll jump in, and it's probably going to bleed into the second question in the chat about rural communities. I think our work in this space and you guys' work in this space as well is, although it may not be unique, it is, well, although it may not be original, it is unique, you just say it that way. I think there are very few places in the country that are probably prepared for some of the data research that's been trickling down. We've gotten ours from the West Coast, Oregon, California, and it's making its way this way. I'm sure there's data-informed trauma data out there as well from other parts of the country. But the one thing that Colorado has that's unique to other parts of the country is that there's an ecosystem that's been created for marginalized folks. Traditionally, that hasn't been that space. And I think that, you know, as we look to even within our state and in some of the rural communities, how do we get more supports in community? How do we get more resources to the community? How do we get more folks in community who know community? Because community knows what community needs. And so if we're looking to try to move in a space to where we're replicating things, and I think we give we do a great disservice to folks in community. I don't think there's a cookie cutter model for any community, for trauma-informed services, for victims' voices or victim services. And even on the Crimes Act, that list is extensive. And so some of those crimes they may have never experienced, but they could relate to some of the other things that are maybe are not on that list. So to Jason's point, there are some norms that have changed. There are some new norms that have come into play. And I think that as we move forward, even within our state, as their service has been expanded, this work that we're a part of, that we're privileged to be a part of, along with all of you guys, is going to be changing. I think that there are, well, I know for a fact that there are folks who are looking at what Colorado is doing as a model in other places. How do we make sure that we continue to do good work here and try to inform those other places of what they can do to shore up their community issues. So I'll stop there, but I think that it's kind of a slippery slope to think about replicating. We're very specific about who we target. We're very specific about the communities that we want to go after. And we're very specific about how we want to see things change in not only in the greater Denver metro area, but throughout our state. So if we can focus on being very, very micro in that work, I think the macro will take care of itself and the folks who really need this data as we continue to put it out and continue to do the work in this space will benefit and their communities will be able to do the work that their communities need for them to be successful and to be healthy.
Yeah, I just want to piggyback on a lot of what Henry was talking about.
from personal experience and the work that I do in the community with my Bella Organizing Committee as their mental health grant manager, that whole movement, the whole movement that's happening now in Montbella, I don't know if you guys are familiar with all that's happening, but the whole movement was based off of a group of people coming together that's saying, we are community members. We know what we want as community members. Let's survey the community to see what they want and need as community members. And then we will build services and go after funding to support those needs. And I think that at the end of the day, community-driven change, community-driven development, community-driven services is what is needed in order to really address on a communal level, because we're all part of the community, right? To really address on a communal level what needs to happen. And that is something I would like to see all the way across the board, you know? But it needs to be strategic. I was just having a discussion the other day with some folks with the city and county of Denver, and there's like four different work groups being put together to address the same thing that multiple people have reached out to me about. And I'm just like, I don't need to sit on four different work groups to address the same thing in four different departments. I need to sit on one work group with all departments working together in order to find solutions that are community driven. So that's really what it comes down to. And I think that if we can get away from this whole, we have all of these, what do you call it? Like people are working towards getting their checklist checked off, right? Everybody's working on their specific checklist. And when we get away from what your checklist is and what the next person's checklist is and everything like that, and just start focusing on what the community's checklist is, and then getting out of our silos and start working together as a group, as a community ourselves, then we can actually get the work done. And I think that that's what we've been doing within this committee. That's it.
And then the other question in the chat was, what similarities and differences do you think we might see if these questions were asked in rural Colorado, and will more focus groups be held in rural areas? I can touch on that last part. So our focus groups were open to anyone in Colorado, that we just had a few requirements, that they were over the age of 18, and that they had experienced at least one crime in their lifetime, or that they had interacted with the criminal legal system. And I do know that some of the people that have participated in our groups are from rural locations. And so they did speak to and that did come up in a focus group, kind of the differences between more rural locations and needing more services versus being in a more metro area that has a lot of services in it. But we're ending our focus groups in this month. So we will not be doing any more focus groups, but I will say that we did have representation from rural areas within our focus groups. I don't know if anybody wants to touch on differences they might think we might see if the questions were asked in rural Colorado, or if you guys have any thoughts on that.
Aaron, did you say differences between rural and urban focus groups?
Mm-hmm. Well, this is just asking about like the survey data, specifically what similarities and differences we might see if we asked that survey in a more rural.
I honestly think that I think the biggest differences between the rural and the urban surveys would most likely be the types of crimes you see, you know. I think one of the biggest crimes out in the rural areas is more property crimes and theft and, you know, things like that. Just because there's less people and, you know, there's more opportunities out there for people to be victims of theft and stuff like that. But I think some of the similarities, though, would most likely be the interaction with law enforcement, and also I think some of the demographics would also be similar as well. You know what I mean? So as far as like age groups and how they interact with law enforcement and how they feel about law enforcement. And, you know, there probably are a lot of people that interact with the local law enforcement out in the rural areas a little more freely.
I don't know. Yeah, I think that we can probably do some due diligence and do a little bit more research about that. But in general, I feel like if there's a service gap, then there's a service gap. And it's about whether or not those services are accessible. And if they're accessible, do people know how to maneuver the systems in order to get the services that they need? So whether you're rural or you're urban, like we can have the same conversation with somebody living in the city that just doesn't know how to maneuver the system in order to get the services that they need, not that the services aren't there. You know, so then that's another question. Are the services actually there to be offered? And then, how can we make sure that we're filling the gaps where the gaps need to be filled? And then how can we make sure that there's the awareness there where there's just an informational gap? You know, is there a service gap or is there an informational gap? And those are the questions that I think that we need to be asking.
And Wendy Talley is the coordinator for this grant. And I know that there's a lot of interest in the state in expanding statewide. The focus has been in Denver Metro. We also have programming some of the other grantees in Colorado Springs. But I know that there's been a lot of interest in this program given its success.
And then Jocelyn, I can answer your question. She asked if we, in addition to asking about law enforcement perception, did you ask participants about crimes committed against them by law enforcement? We didn't specifically ask them about crimes committed against them by law enforcement. I think in some of their responses, open-ended responses, some of that might have come out. And I think a lot of the focus groups, some of them have brought up things that interactions with law enforcement and similar things like that. So I think our focus groups might elucidate that question further. That was the last question in the chat. I don't know if anybody else has any other final questions or thoughts that they want to share from the leadership team. And I can turn it back over to Maria, if not.
Great, thank you all so much. I'm gonna be sending a follow-up email here shortly with contact information for Aaron and Jason. And they can direct your questions to the leadership team as appropriate or as needed. I'll also be including in that follow-up email a copy of the PDF slides that you saw during this session. I'll also be including that link that you saw in the chat box for the current report of the findings that they shared with us in the session today. So I want to end us on kind of that question that you had, Aaron, there, whether there's anything that you all want to leave us with, like a final thought, a final moment of what you would like folks to take away from the session today.
I'm going to leave that to the leadership team.
Okay, I can help answer that. As far as the way that I'm, the things that I've worked on, with the community leadership team and the things that I've learned. I would like everyone to take away from this information just to be more aware of the community, be more aware of what's going on in your own neighborhood, in your own community, and how we can make a difference and how we can make changes and positive movements forward to creating opportunities for change. And that includes, you know, talking with youth and being a community member who's active and participating in you know, everyday movements of your community, you know, making sure that the kids aren't destroying property, or, you know, they're not being disrespectful to other people's property. And, you know, really just being able to learn, you know, from our, you know, from the next generation, as well as leave them with insight and knowledge of, you know, things we can do to make our community safer and more secure. And that usually, I mean, sometimes that doesn't include law enforcement, you know, it's more, I guess, being a community member who, you know, is able to, you know, be out there and let people know not to do bad things, I guess, you know.
I guess, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
So I think I was just going to kind of piggyback off a little bit of what Ray said, which is, you know, I think that our goal here is to make sure that all voices are heard, to really go out there and figure out what's happening in marginalized communities, people that don't feel like they have been heard historically in the past, making sure that we're adding that those voices to data. And then that data is accessible for everybody to look at and say, okay, here's a different perspective. You know, this is something that's happening. And I just want everybody to walk away saying, you know, there are people out here doing this work, trying to get a piece of the bigger picture, you know, more accessible to everybody, to the providers, to the community, to everybody in our circles and things like that. There are way more voices out there than just what has been historically the Caucasian voice when it comes to victimization, you know? So we just wanna make sure that those voices are heard and they have a platform as well.
And I'm sure we've all heard it before, but, you know, hurt people. But heal people. So I think a shift in our focus from, you know, the status quo to truly a focus on prevention and healing and liberation, and really asking the question, what kind of society do we want to be, is fundamental to all this. Thank you again. To my teammates and to all of you for being here today.
Thank you all. Troy, did you want to share something?
Sure, yeah, but I just concur with everything that has been shared from both, from Ray, LaToya, and Jason. I think that we're just at a critical moment in time, history, where we all have to do our part in not only making sure that our voices are heard, but that we become actionable on our words, and that we, for lack of a better phrase at the moment, really hold some of those traditional powers to be feet to the fire. In terms of change, and changed it is for the wellness of the community at large, and not for any other interest. But so, thank you all, and appreciate your time today.
Oh, hey, I wanted to add to that, Troy, what you were saying. But that is actually something that I forgot to mention, was accountability. Making sure people are accountable for their actions, whether it's community or, you know, people who are, you know, positions of authority that help out our community. So that's the other thing I want everyone to take away from, making people accountable for their actions and their, you know, how they produce our, you know, in our community. And thank you everybody for participating. Thanks everyone. Everyone's doing a great job, and I'm glad to see that there's so many people interested in making a change.
Thank you, Troy. Thank you, Ray. Thank you all. Thank you for presenting this important information, for kind of bringing us back to what Henry, you said. I really like that. It's not original, but it's unique. And so hopefully this helps us to make it not unique and more common in Colorado and throughout. Speaking of community and community engagement, we are going to have a webinar next week on the 23rd at 10 a.m. We're gonna have Meghna Bhatt from Valor US, formerly CalCASA, presenting on using storytelling as innovative community engagement tools for primary prevention efforts. So keep an eye out for that. We hope to see you all next week for that webinar as well. Just a quick reminder again, keep an eye out for an email from me to get those materials that we discussed earlier, and so you can get contact information for this amazing team. Please remember to fill out the survey that will be included in that email. That's helpful for us. Like I mentioned, I share that with our presenters, and it's helpful for us to know what you all are needing and wanting in the future. So thanks again for attending. Thank you all for being here and presenting. We really appreciate you, and thank you for the work you're doing.
Thank you.